Good morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to your Father's house. Would you bow your heads and pray with me? Good morning, Father. We thank you for Sunday, for the Lord's Day. We thank you, God, for a place to worship and a people to worship with. But most of all, our great, great God to worship and serve. I pray that each one of us would sense your presence in a way that gives us courage, that gives us strength, that gives us hope and peace. I pray that those who are worshiping with us online will also sense your presence with them, and that very soon, if they are able, they will be back in the pew worshiping alongside us. God, throughout this service, may you be honored, and may we find ourselves closer to the God who loves us with a love that will never let us go. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Do me a favor, please, and sign the little yellow attendance card that's in the pew rack. Sign up for the Wednesday night meal. Leave us any prayer requests, and I promise you that you will be prayed for. I want to thank all the folks that filled in for me last Sunday. Evidently, it was a great service. I watched it online, and then one of the elders who sits at the back took a picture, and he said, "We had a full house." And I said, "Man, that is great." He said, "Yeah, we hadn't had that many people since the last time you were out." So, really made me feel good, right? It's wonderful. Look with me at the half sheet. Deacons, you have a meeting after this service. Our senior adults go to the Rock and Soul Museum and out to lunch on Tuesday. And then we volunteer at Memphis Union Mission at 4:45 on Tuesday. Look at that whole schedule of events that happen on Wednesday night here at Highland Heights and plug in to one of those groups if you have not yet done that. Our Hope Circle, which is a women's Bible study group, they meet on Thursday at 10:30, and they're inviting any of the ladies to join them for lunch and for the study. You'll see a beautiful rose here for a beautiful baby girl, the newest baby in our church family. I got to hold her Friday. Her name is Claire, and she is a doll, and I look forward to you getting to see her. She is the daughter of Brandon and Montana Hardy. I want to welcome our new music director, Terry Walker. You're in for a treat, as the choir has been finding out as he leads us in worship. And thank you to Marianne Cole for your wonderful service as our interim. I really appreciate all you did. We collect our poor and needy offering today. And then I'm having a pastor's lunch on Sunday the 27th over here in the conference room. And this is for anyone who's interested in learning more about faith in Jesus and learning more about this church. I'd love for you to have lunch with me. We'll have a time of Q&A. I'll keep you about an hour and look forward to many of you coming to that. Jeff has something he'd like to do before we sing, and then we'll continue our worship.
Well, I know it's a little unconventional. We usually get right into the singing, but we got two young ladies that's in my class that are going to be heading off to college this week, and I know they're going to hate me for doing this. Maybe they'll appreciate the things that I've gotten for them, but I've got a couple of gift bags that's got some stuff that I wish I would have had when I went to college, some candy and some snacks and devotion books and all that good stuff, you know. And when I was buying the candy, I was still on prep for my bodybuilding show, so probably more candy than anything else. I was buying the stuff I wanted to eat, but if Alina and Kira would come up here with me, in the eyes of everybody in the congregation, they don't want to be up here.
Oh, you got the broken string bag. And I'd like to ask Tim to pray for these girls. Lord knows for many of us that have been through college that lots of unexpected things can happen, and a lot sometimes, you know, it's stressful and it's hard, and they got a journey, but I want them to know that this congregation, this church, and me as the teacher of their class will be with them every step of the way as much as I can be.
So we've watched these girls grow up if you've been in the church for a while, and we're proud of you. We're going to miss you. Tell the congregation where you're going to school, and then let me pray for you.
Syracuse University in New York.
University of Kentucky.
All right. Let me pray for you. Oh, Lord, our God, we thank you that these girls are yours. They belong to you. They were raised in the faith. They profess faith in you long ago. And we thank you, God, for the minds you've given them. We thank you, God, for the hearts you've given them. And we ask you to keep them safe, to keep them ever close to you. We pray that they will find a good college group to serve with, to worship with. We pray that we will see them often. And we thank you most of all that you love them with a love that will never let them go. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Love y'all.
And now we can get on to the singing, the normal part of the service. If you would, please stand with me this morning as we sing our song of the month, Blessed Be Your Name.
Blessed be your name in a land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. I'll walk through the wilderness. Blessed be. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory. Name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name. The Lord, blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Thank you.
Well, that F sharp is hard to hit. If you would, please join with me in the call to worship this morning, coming from Psalms 46, verses 1 and 10. God is our refuge and strength. Be still and know that I am God.
I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth.
And please continue to worship with me as we sing our next song, Word of God Speak.
To be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still. You're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself in the midst of you.
Like I told the 8:30 service, y'all are going to get tired of seeing my face and hearing my voice. It's a blessing to be here. It's a blessing to be able to lead us in our confession of sin and our in our prayer, excuse me. And it's a blessing to know that all the sins of the world, all of my sins, the sins of everyone out there, the price has already been paid by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father God, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for this day, Lord, and the many blessings that you give us. Father, We ask that you open our hearts to receive your word, Lord, and that you allow us to sing your praise to the highest capacity, and also that we glorify your name to the highest capacity, Father. And we pray it in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Together, let's say what we believe using those ancient words in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the one holy and universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to be seated. All right. Good morning, everybody. All right. I have something that I want to show you. A lady in the church made this for me, and it sort of looks like a painting, but it's actually cross stitch. And I bet Miss Deborah could explain cross stitch for us. It makes little X's, so every one of these little colors is a little X from thread, all these different threads. Now, this is a picture of something that's in our sanctuary. Does anybody know where it is? Where is it, Levi? That's right. All right, see up there? So this is made from a picture of that stained glass window, and it took her 10 months to do this. And I'm going to leave it up here on the front pew so you can see it. She really worked hard on this. I really treasure it. Now, can you tell me in that stained glass window and in this picture, who is the person in the middle? It's Jesus. And it's Jesus as the Good Shepherd. And so that window, the Good Shepherd window, came from our old church. Our church relocated. It was in kind of Midtown, the Highland Heights area near the zoo. And we brought that window with us. And I treasure that window. Now, we have a screen that we use, and we put a lot of things on there, but when we have communion, I like for Mr. Jason to raise that screen so we can see Jesus the Good Shepherd. And the reason I like him to do that is because Jesus said, I'm the Good Shepherd, and I give my life for my sheep. And so what we have under this cloth is communion that reminds us that Jesus did give his blood, his body, for us, because we're the sheep. So look up at the window, and you'll see the little lamb Jesus is carrying. Sometimes we're like that little lamb, and we need Jesus to carry us and forgive us. And sometimes we're like the bigger lamb down at Jesus' side, and we're helping others. We're making sure that Jesus is carrying them. Does that make sense? Good stuff. All right, so I'm going to eventually hang this in my office. But I want y'all to see it. Come up after church and look at the work that Melanie Hayes did. I really do treasure it. All right, hands together, eyes closed, and we'll say, Father, thank you for being our good shepherd.
Thank you for being our good shepherd.
I love you.
I love
you. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Thank you, girls. Let's continue our worship now through the giving of our tithes and our offerings. Pray with me, please. Father, you've given us so much in this life, and then the promise of the life to come. And we thank you for also giving us a desire and the ability to give a portion of those gifts back to the work of your church. We thank you for all the things that happen at the top of this hill, 7 days a week. Worship, PDO, AA meetings, basketball games in the gym, Sunday school classes, Bible studies, on and on and on. And we thank you, God, for what our gifts are enabling far beyond these walls, particularly the work you've given us to do with missionaries in our orphanage in Kenya. Please bless each gift and each giver and all those recipients. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, amen. Please be seated. The ancient paths, the one we're going to look at today, is solitude. Being by yourself, quietly seeking God. The Old Testament lesson is one of many places in the Old Testament where we see solitude. And this is old Jacob. His name means cheat or cheater. He's a scoundrel. But you know, God loves scoundrels like Jacob, like us. And when God gets him by himself, he changes him. Genesis 32, verse 22. That night Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two maidservants, and his 11 sons and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. I want to stop here a minute. I did this at 8:30. Just because the Bible describes the fact that Jacob was a polygamist doesn't mean that it's saying it's right. Much of the trouble Jacob had is because he didn't stay married to just one woman. Verse 23. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip, so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with men and have overcome." Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the tendon attached to the socket of the hip, because the socket of Jacob's hip was touched near the tendon. And then from the New Testament, one verse about one of the many times Jesus found solitude. You'll find it in Mark chapter 1, verse 35. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. May God help us understand the reading of his word. Bow your heads with me. Oh God, we admit that there is very little quiet, peaceful solitude in our lives. Instead, there's lots of movement, lots of noise. And so would you crowd out that noise and all the things we have to do and places we need to go, that in this time of worship and really in the rest of the time you give us in this life, We will seek you quietly, peacefully. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm beginning all these sermons in this series with a hymn story, the story behind so many of the hymns we sing and were written long ago. And I talked to you about Fanny Crosby and told you that she wrote so many hymns that we probably would be looking at another one, and we are. I am thine, O Lord, that we'll sing after communion. Though blind from the age of 6 weeks, Fanny Crosby wrote over 9,000 hymns. Isn't that hard to believe? And over 100 years after her death, we still sing many of the songs she wrote. I Am Thine, O Lord, is one of them, and this is the story behind that hymn. One evening, Fanny Crosby was visiting her friend William Doane, who often put music to her poems. And their conversation turned to the nearness of God. She was touched by their talk, and she wrote the words of this hymn before she retired that night. Doane added the music the next morning, and thus we suddenly have a hymn. Fanny Crosby had a talent for focusing attention on Christ. And in that way, though she was blind, she opened the eyes of believers everywhere. The third verse of this hymn is about solitude. Oh, the pure delight of a single hour that before thy throne I spend, when I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. Let's talk about solitude this morning. Richard Foster, the Quaker, has written more about spiritual disciplines than anyone else, has said this: solitude involves developing an inner silence in order to listen to God. I like that. An inner silence in order to listen to God. Let me ask you a question. Are you a good listener? Most of us aren't. We're good talkers. Well, you know, God gave us two ears and one mouth, and there might be something to our anatomy in that we need to be better listeners. And let me ask you this, are you comfortable with silence? If I were sitting out there, I'd be thinking, is the preacher ever going to get on with the sermon? Are you comfortable with silence? Most of us aren't. That's why even when you see people running or walking, they've got a headset on, they're listening to music. We aren't very good with silence. How about waiting? Are you good with waiting? Solitude is waiting on God. Friday night, Renee and I went out to celebrate our 34th anniversary. Can you believe she's put up with me? Really longer than that, because we dated before we married, of course. 34 years. I won't tell you the restaurant, but we went to get a good steak. I had reservations made for 6 o'clock. We got there right at 6 o'clock. They sat us. And at 6:45, we still didn't have our food. And I sometimes get hangry, but I was trying to be good. The waitress came over and she said, let me go check on that steak. And finally, when she brought the food at 7 o'clock, she said, I need to talk to the manager. You had to wait too long. Well, we were scarfing down our food because we were going to see a movie at 7:30. The food was delicious, and the manager came over, and she said, how was the food? I said, it was good, very good, always good. And she said, well, let me do something for you. I understand it's your anniversary, and you had to wait a long time. How about if I get you a dessert? And Renee said, well, we really can't eat dessert. We'd have to put it in the car, and it's too hot tonight. We're going to a movie, so we couldn't do that. And she said, well, let me see what I can do. So she went away for a little while, and we were scarfing down our food. She comes back, and she had the little booklet or whatever that has the check in it usually, and I opened it up, and inside was an anniversary card. And she said, hope you enjoyed your meal. Thanks for choosing us. And so I said, you mean the meal is free? And she said, yes. And my Scottish soul said, yes. So why do I tell you this story? Because waiting can sometimes be worth the wait. When you wait on God, listen to me. When you wait on God, it's worth the wait. His blessings will follow. Do you like to be alone? Solitude involves being alone. I don't like to be alone very often. I'm funny about that. If I'm in my office studying, I'm good to go. I do that a lot. But when it's time to eat lunch, I want to eat with somebody. And so on those rare occasions when I'm the only one up here at lunchtime, I'm not going to go over there and sit in the fellowship hall and eat by myself. I'll just bring my sandwich or whatever and eat in my office. I don't like to be by myself. But are we ever really alone? No. Because Jesus said, I am with you always. So even in solitude, you're not alone. I want to give you some biblical examples of solitude. And the first one is this mysterious passage we read from Genesis about old Jacob, the cheat, the scoundrel. He'd cheated his dad, he cheated his brother, he cheated his mama. He went off, he was ready to cheat his father-in-law, he cheated his wives, his kids. He wasn't a very good person. But he knew it deep down, and that's where you start. You have to admit, yeah, I need some changing. And the way that God got a hold of that old boy was one night when he was by himself, he'd finally reached the end of his rope. And the Bible says that a man who was God came to wrestle with Jacob. So who was the man? It was Jesus. Pre-incarnate form of Jesus. Jacob was strong and they wrestled all night. You know, when you wrestle, I used to wrestle with my uncles, with my boys when they were younger. You know, after a little while, you got to get your breath. Well, they went at it all night long. And Jacob realized that the man he was wrestling with was divine. And so he said, I want a blessing from you. And that's what solitude is. Sometimes God wrestles with you because we're hard-headed and hard-hearted sometimes. And he has to wrestle with us and pin us down in order for us to say, all right, I need you. The second example is from the psalmist. Be still and know that I am God. And still here in the Hebrew literally means be quiet. And that's what it means in the South very often. If my grandmother said, Timothy Shawn Foster, be still, she meant for me to be quiet. Quit back talking. Do what I say. And God sometimes does that with us. He says, Timothy Shawn Foster, would you shut up? Would you do what the Bible says to do and find how you'll be blessed? And then the third example is from the life of Jesus. Very often we read in the Bible that early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house where he was staying, and he went off to a solitary place, a quiet place, where he prayed. If you've got the television on and the computer on and your AirPods in, you're listening to music, and all this stuff is going on all the time, you're not praying like you should. You've got to shut that stuff down and be quiet and pray to the God who made you. There are some misconceptions about solitude. The first one is that solitude is lonely. Well, no, loneliness is depressing. You know, loneliness is a child who just cannot get over being left at school or in the nursery. Or it's when you go off to college, and I experienced this. I probably cried more than my parents. I was lonely. That's not solitude. Solitude is being with God, and it's connecting with Him. It's a connection with someone greater than yourself. A second misconception is that being alone is the same thing as solitude. No, you can be alone and do all kinds of things. If you're in a deer stand by yourself, you're alone, but you may not be praying. You may not be reflecting on the Bible. Solitude is different. It's intentionally being alone and focusing on God. And the third misconception is that silence is always uncomfortable. It's kind of an American thing. We like noise. Silence, for many of us, is necessary. We need a little silence. Makes me think about an assignment that we had in seminary when I went to preacher school. And our professor said, "You gentlemen need some silence, and I'm going to send you to a monastery for the day." And we thought, what? It's a Catholic monastery in Conyers, Georgia. And these monks practice solitude, silence. And the professor said, "So you better not talk. Your grade's going to count on if you talk." And he said, "I'll be wandering all around the grounds of that monastery. If I catch you talking, you fail." Well, I like to talk. And if I'm going to school with a bunch of preachers, that means we all like to talk. But we did it. And finally came the time for supper. This monastery had a reputation for the food they raised. Supper was good and silent. And then came the peach cobbler. We're in Georgia, right? And this monk, and I know to this day he did it on purpose, he walked around with one of those dream cream things and went on each one of our cobblers, and we were trying so hard not to laugh, just almost choking on our laughter. But that silence was good for us. And you need to practice silence sometimes. It's good for you. What keeps us from solitude? Well, first of all, we're easily distracted, aren't we? Squirrel? Right? We're distracted by our to-do list, we're distracted by television, we're distracted by social media, on and on it goes. We're easily distracted. And then we're often afraid of silence because it gives us this feeling that we're out of control, we're not in charge, as if we really were in charge of our lives. Who's in charge of your life? God is. And then another thing that keeps us from solitude is we're afraid of intimacy with God. I'm sorry that we're like that. And I think the reason is because we know that when we connect with God, He's going to change us. And there are some things about you and me that He needs to change. There are at least six purposes of solitude, and the first one is to get to know God better. And there's this idea in our culture that's promoted by the left very often, you can't know God, there isn't even a God to know. Well, you most certainly can know God. And if you'll spend time regularly in this old book, you will grow to love Him and cherish Him. The second purpose is for us to know ourselves better. Our sinfulness. But not just that. Our capacity to love. There's a great capacity to love in this room. And the more time you spend in solitude, the more you'll get in touch with that. And I think a third purpose is to know others better. Because once we've faced our own brokenness, we're more compassionate to other people. Because we're all broken. All of us. And solitude gives you a deeper faith by listening to God. It gives you deeper prayers. That's what Fanny Crosby was talking about. When I kneel in prayer, and with Thee, my God, I commune. As friend with friend. And solitude gives us deeper compassion because our empathy leads to action. I want to end by giving you some practical advice on solitude. The first thing is, remember that you're never really alone. Jesus has promised, "I am with you always to the close of the age." Take advantage of brief solitudes throughout the day. Maybe it's when you first wake up. And don't do like me and just jump out of bed and go to the kitchen and eat breakfast. Lay there a minute. Sit there a minute. Pray for a minute. Maybe it's sometime when you're in the car. Turn off the radio and just spend some time with your Father in heaven before you go to where, before you do whatever you're going to do. Maybe it's before you go to sleep at night. The third thing I would say is regularly go to a quiet place. And you got to make it a quiet place because of radio, TV, social media. You got to work at it. Years ago, when my mom and dad moved out to Arlington, they still had some woods in the back of their house, unlike any of the other yards. And my mom had my brother and me make her a path back to where she had a bench. And that was her quiet place. And I had to learn that because when I'd go to their house, you know, I'd want to find her and hug her neck. Well, if I saw my little mother sitting on that bench, then I needed to wait because she was having some time with God. So y'all listen, when you see your family or friends quietly praying or just sitting reading the Bible, give them that space. And last of all, just try it. It's what we do every time we have the Lord's Supper. Because the bread is brought to you and you have a few minutes to reflect on the goodness of God in your life. The juice is brought to you and you have a few moments to reflect on the mercy of the God who loves you. Let's bow our heads. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for giving your very life for us. Thank you for being our example in all things. And make us to know that if you, the incarnate Son of God, needed to slip away early in the morning to find a place to pray, surely we need it much, much more. As we come now to the Lord's table, help us to know beyond a shadow of a doubt that your love binds us to you and to one another. We ask this in your name. Amen. Will the elders serving the sacrament please come to the table? This table has been set for us by volunteers in the church. The bread, as you know, if you worship here regularly, is homemade. Those little plastic things that you can buy. The grape juice is lovingly placed in these cups because we believe communion is important. I was with a sailor in one of our units last Friday, and he said, you know, you Presbyterians seem to know that communion's important. He said, my church, I can't remember the last time I had communion. And we do it once a month. The only reason that you shouldn't take a piece of bread or a cup of juice is if you don't know who Jesus is. And if you don't yet know, would you spend some time with me so we could talk about Him? You need to know Him. But if you do know Him, please partake in the sacrament. Reflect in solitude on the goodness of God. Let's pray together. Almighty God, please sanctify these elements to that spiritual use to which you have ordained them, that we, your people gathered here, may find ourselves nourished, quenched by amazing grace. In Jesus' name, amen. We read in the New Testament in 1 Corinthians 11 from the pen of the Apostle Paul that on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And after having given thanks, as has been done in his name, he broke that bread. As I, ministering in his name, have broken this bread and will give it to you. He told them that evening in the upper room, this is my body given for you. do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep." Let's all taste and see that the Lord is good. Then the Bible tells us that after the same manner, our Savior also took a cup. And after having given thanks, as has been done in his name, he gave that cup to his disciples. "As I, ministering in his name, give this cup to you," he told them that evening in the upper room, "this cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for many for the remission of sins. All of you drink of it." Something happened, and now I know He touched me and made me whole. Jesus touched me and made me whole. Oh, He touched me. The very lifeblood of the Lord Jesus Christ was shed for us. Would you pray with me, please? Thank you, God, for touching us with your love, with your grace, with your mercy. And because we've been forgiven, make us the kind of people who forgive others. Even those that it's hardest to forgive. Give us good boundaries, but cleanse our souls, our lives, with your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen.
For those of you who haven't met me yet, my name is Terry Walker. I am the new director of music here, and it is a blessing to be in service with you guys every Sunday. I've spent the better part of 20 years serving officially and unofficially in churches all over the state of Mississippi. I will be sometimes accompanied by my wife and six-month-old daughter. A little more frequently, my son, Terry III, Tripp, will be with me. And we just thank you for welcoming us into your church home. Pastor Tim was talking a little bit about solitude and listening to God. And it's so important that we do that in hopes that we're drawn closer to Him and receive the blessings that He has for us. So let's all stand together and sing hymn number 358, I Am Thine, O Lord.
Draw me near.
Amen. Has it not been good to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Go out now and practice solitude. And as you go, may grace, mercy, and peace be with you and all those you love in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.